Well, good morning. Glad to have each and every one of you here this morning and enjoying this nice, beautiful spring weather we're having. Isn't this great? It's just awesome. Great to see so many of you come out today, especially if you're joining us via the internet. We are always honored to have you join us on Sunday mornings. My name is Teddy Baker, along with my wife Jan, Jim and Sandra Penner. We do this ministry called Jesus and Jeans, because I always wear jeans and tell people if you don't like that speed, you sure ain't gonna like the next one, because it gets ugly in a hurry anyway. So. But we're glad to have you worship here at the cottage. We do this every Sunday morning and from 10:30 to 11:30. And so we certainly are honored to have you. We're going to sing a little bit. Everybody ready to do a little praise and worship? Me, 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 me. Yeah. This is a great old hymn. Sounds so great. I just love to hear your voices. And oh man, what a great spirit. This is my desire. To honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. Every breath that I take, the moment I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. This is my pray this morning, and several prayer requests that I want to lift up. Got a call from Bill and Becky Thomas this weekend, and they had placed, I think Bill's father, I think that's correct, into a hospice facility. And so I want you to remember Bill and Becky, and certainly their family, as they navigate through these waters. They're always difficult. And I also want to remember our parents, Jim and Barbara. We've also called hospice in for Barbara, and they're going to come twice a week. What a great organization they are, and filled with so much compassion, and offer so much to families that really thank God for them, and keep Jan and I, and we're very blessed to have Lee, our daughter, with us today, and so keep us in your prayers as we are there as caregivers and helpers at their home, and trying to help them as well. Lee has a friend up in New York, Eliza Parrish, who is 26 years old, and has they found out she has like stage 4 ovarian cancer. And 26, and so she's at the Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York, and so we want to lift her up today. Also, Rick and Rosie's daughter, Shannon, we're glad to have you guys back, Rick. They're half the year in Florida and half the year up here, and it's always a blessing to have you guys come back and join us. So Shannon's going in for some tests as well, and so we want to just lift her up in prayer. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you, God, for this day. This is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And Father, we lift all of these prayer requests today to you. As the great physician, we pray, Father, that you would bring healing, and you would work through doctors and medicines and even miracles, that you would intervene and bring healing and health in whatever way is needed, God, in every situation that we've mentioned today. And Father, as the counselor, we pray that you would come alongside each and every family member, each person who is dealing with health issues, and that, God, you would just walk closely alongside, that the peace of Christ would truly rule in their heart. We love you, Lord. We thank you for every single day that you give us. We don't take that for granted. And we ask your blessings today, Lord, on our service and looking at your word. I pray, God, that you would just reach down and give each one of us a holy hug. And just let us feel your presence in a very real, a very genuine way. Thank you for loving us, Lord. We ask your blessings today in the wonderful name of your Son, Jesus. And all God's children said,
amen.
Amen. We're going to be in the book of John today. And I'm going to read from the Message translation. I love teaching from the Message translation because it's just such an easy translation to read. And it's just written in layman's terms and, you know, made it real easy for moi to understand. And I like that. I like to be able to understand God's word in a very real way, personal way. So we're going to be looking at John chapter 20. If you have your Bibles, turn to John chapter 20. And we're going to be looking at verses 19 through 31, which is kind of an extended scripture. A lot of pastors, they take these scriptures and they'll take each event after the resurrection of Christ. They will preach individual messages on each one of them. And I've done that before, and so I thought, well, today I'll just group them all together. And that'll be sort of the Cliff Note version of all of these scriptures and all of these sermons. Beginning in verse 19, it says this. Later on that day, the disciples had gathered together, but fearful of the Jews, had locked all the doors in the house. Jesus entered and stood among them and said, peace to you. Then he showed them his hands and side. The disciples, seeing the master with their own eyes, were exuberant. Jesus repeated his greeting. Peace to you. Just as the Father sent me, I send you. Then he took a deep breath and breathed into them. Receive the Holy Spirit, he said. If you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them? But Thomas, sometimes called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples told him, we saw the master. But he said, unless I see the nail holes in his hands, put my finger in the nail holes and stick my hand in his side, I won't believe it. 8 days later, his disciples were again in the room, and this time Thomas was with them. And Jesus came through the locked doors, stood among them, and said, peace to you. Then he focused his attention on Thomas. Take your finger and examine my hands. Take your hand and stick it in my side. Don't be unbelieving. Believe. Thomas said, my master, my God. Jesus said, so you believe because you've seen with your own eyes. Even better blessings are in store for those who believe without seeing. Guess who that is? Then in verse 30, it said this. Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book. These are written down so you will believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And in the act of believing, have real and eternal life in the way he personally revealed it. Powerful scriptures. You know, last week when we were all gathered here for our sunrise service, wasn't that literally, I mean, just a beautiful, magnificent sunrise? The picture you posted, Jeannie, was just spectacular on Facebook. You know, it was so unusual that on this side, while we were waiting on the sun to come up, we had a full moon. And then as the sun rose, there was the sunrise and the full moon, and everything was just right there. It was also April Fool's Day. I can't remember. And so we had the April Fool's trick played on us, because I set my alarm clock for like 4 o'clock in the morning, a.m. But somehow it got switched to p.m. Operator error. So we woke up like at 6 o'clock in Gainesville. April Fool. So we blasted out of there and actually got here on time to get set up and get ready. But wow. And just what an incredible turnout for our sunrise service. Sandra told me she counted like 115 people for a little room that seats about 50 comfortably. It's amazing. God continues to show up in this place, and He continues to bless this ministry with new faces and new people to connect with. As Bobby said last Sunday morning, he said last week, he said, God was all over this mountain this morning. You know, and I have to agree with him wholeheartedly. It was a very special time together, and I am so thankful for each and every one of you that continue to come. Now, here we are today. We come to worship 1 week later. And some of you may have a sense that it's life back to normal as life can be. Some of you may be facing some of the same difficulties that were there before you celebrated Easter last week. Some may be enjoying the victory that celebrating the resurrection of Christ brought into your life last Sunday. Whatever your situation might be, we're glad that you're with us this morning. You know, there are several ways that you can recognize that it's the week after Easter. First of all, there's not a lily in sight. Secondly, Walgreens, CVS, and Walmart, they rotate all the Easter candy, you know, to the sale tables out front and start bringing out the Mother's Day cards and all those gift ideas. In most churches, you'll have no trouble finding a seat there today. We don't have that problem. Amen. And then everyone is glad to wait another 12 months before singing Up From the Grave He Arose, you know. So today, the title of the message is Easter is Over. What's next? You know, the followers of Jesus, they're wondering about that very question. The resurrection has taken place. The grave is empty. The women have shared the message that the angel gave them, that Jesus is alive and that He will go before them into Galilee. Now, they've traveled to Galilee as Jesus instructed them to do. And they're together, and they're obviously concerned. They've locked the doors. They're wondering, what's next for us? They're afraid. Why did Jesus want them to go to Galilee in the first place? Well, I did a little research, and I found three reasons that made a lot of sense to me. First, Galilee was the native country of the apostles. And so, after the death of Jesus, they were purposing in their own hearts to return to Galilee so that they might live more safely among their own relations, their own people. And secondly, because in Galilee, Christ willed to show Himself openly to all of His assembled disciples. He openly revealed Himself as to who He was. And for the Jews, they would not have permitted them to assemble in Judea. And then thirdly, because in Galilee, Christ had, for the most part, that's where He did a lot of His preaching and performed many, many miracles. in that area of Galilee. And so next, the question might have been, well, when will he come? Because even though Jesus had said, look, I'm going to go before you into Galilee, so far he hadn't shown up. And so they may have been thinking, you know, well, when he does come, what will he do? What will he say? What's next? And so, in a way, we ask that same question this morning. What's next? And so, in an effort to answer that question, there are several observations that I want you to see from these scriptures here this morning. The first observation is this. The presence of Jesus brings peace to one another. And Jesus entered the room. He came through. He appeared. He came through locked doors. And he appeared and entered the room and stood before them. And he said, peace to you. In the first meeting, the 11 disciples are gathered together. And by this time, Judas, who had betrayed Jesus, had been replaced by Matthias. And now only Thomas is missing. They're afraid. They're gathered behind locked doors. They all thought he would be king, not killed. They thought that he would conquer, not be crucified. They were afraid the Jewish leaders would come and get them next because they had been his closest friends and might still be planning anarchy. The people who wanted him dead feared that he was alive. And the people who wanted him alive feared that he was dead. Fear filled the room. And then all of a sudden, Jesus was standing in their midst. And he said, peace be to you. Now, to me, this is an amazing picture of grace poured out. Here is Jesus in the midst of his disciples. The same disciples that when Jesus had asked the ones who were with him in the garden to pray, they fell asleep. The same disciples where one betrayed him and sold him out. The same disciples where one denied three times that he even knew Jesus. And when the pressure was on them and Jesus was arrested, they all ran scared for their lives. And yet he addresses them by saying, peace be with you. Now, I would have probably answered him a lot differently. You know, I would have probably, knowing my personality, I'd have probably said, you know something, some kind of friends you guys are. You know, with friends like this, who needs any enemies, you know? But Jesus came in peace. And he offered peace to each of them. Now, here's the picture. The word peace that's used in the New Testament had several different meanings. Peace is used in the New Testament. It's found 91 times. And it's used 24 of those 91 times in the Gospels. And the root denotes completion or wholeness. The general meaning of the root word is of entering into a state of wholeness and unity, a restored relationship. And I believe, my opinion, I believe that that idea was in the heart of Jesus as he spoke to them that day. That our relationship is being restored. It also conveys a wide range of nuances, fulfillment, completion, maturity, soundness, wholeness, harmony, tranquility, security, well-being, welfare, friendship, agreement, success, as well as prosperity. What does this mean for us? It means that no matter what state of mind you're in, no matter what situation you're facing, loss, fear, guilt, emotional instability, physical impairment, no matter what it is, when you choose to come into the presence of the Lord, it is there that you will find peace. Peace for your soul. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you, is what Jesus said. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, and neither let them be afraid. That's John 14, 27. A former president of the Norwegian Academy of Sciences and historians from England, Egypt, Germany, and India, they've come up with this startling information that since 3600 BC, the world has known only 292 years of peace. It's pretty amazing, isn't it? During this period, there have been 14,351 wars, large and small, in which 3.64 billion people have been killed. The value of the property destroyed would pay for a golden belt around the world that would be 97.2 miles wide and 33 feet thick. Since 650 BC, there have also been 1,656 arms races. And only 16 of which have not ended in war. The remainder ended in economic collapse of the countries that were involved. And yet, the Bible tells us that as believers, as His children, that in Christ there is peace. And so how do we possess peace? Must we pray for it? Did they strive for it or work for it, struggle for it, fight for it? No. Not at all. It was a gift. It's a gift. He says, my peace I give to you. Therefore, the disciples, the only thing they need to do, the only thing we need to do, is accept it. Isn't it amazing how simple things become if only we will listen carefully to the Lord? I mean, this doesn't even require any kind of speculation, provocation, assumption, or presumption on our parts. No inference at all. All we have to do is receive His peace. But how does He bestow that gift? Again, listen. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. He bestows peace on earth, peace in us, by the power of His word. He spoke the word, peace be with you. And to be sure they heard Him, He repeated it again, again. Peace be with you. Those disciples were much like us today. First time we hear that, it doesn't sink in real well. because they weren't really listening as they should have been. We have to listen to how the Holy Spirit speaks to us in order to believe and receive His peace. Then and only then can we live in peace. In 1555, there was a man named Nicholas Ridley. He was burned at the stake because of his witness for Christ. And on the night before Ridley's execution, his brother offered to remain with him in the prison chamber to be of assistance and comfort. But Nicholas declined the offer. And he replied that he meant to go to bed that night and sleep as quietly as ever he did in his life, because he knew the peace of God. He could rest in the strength of the everlasting arms of his Lord to meet his need. And guess what? So can we. The second observation is that the promise of the Spirit, the promise of the Holy Spirit, empowers one another. Then he took a deep breath and he breathed into them. Receive the Holy Spirit, he said. Do you ever stop and wonder or think about how powerful the presence of the Holy Spirit is in your life? You know, every now and then we have a little God wink. We have something that happens that, you know, okay, God, you know. And we recognize that. But do you ever stop to think that same power is available to you each and every day that you live? See, when Jesus breathed into them the Holy Spirit, they didn't realize at that time that Jesus was preparing to launch his church. And through this ragtag group of fishermen and tax collectors and doubters and cowards that were his disciples, chosen by Jesus, that they were going to take the message of the gospel throughout the known world. And in the coming days and weeks, people like Peter would preach a message of the gospel, and 3,000 people would come to know the Lord at one time, in one setting. The rest of the disciples would venture out, way out of their comfort zones, and go into the rest of the world to carry the message of Christ to the world. It is the same life that we have received through our relationship with Jesus. Romans 8:15 through 17 says it this way. This resurrection life you received from God is not a timid, grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a childlike, "What's next, Papa?" God's Spirit touches our spirit and confirms who we really are. We know who He is and we know who we are, Father and children. And we know we are going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. And if we go through the hard times with Him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with Him. Billy Graham once wrote that the resurrected Christ also lives today in another very real sense, in the heart of every true believer. Though he is in his glorified body in heaven, yet through the Holy Spirit, he dwells in the heart of every Christian. Billy Graham writes that this is a mystery that is beyond comprehension and yet gloriously true. He writes, when we come to Jesus Christ, we bring everything that we have. Our bodies with all their members, our faculties, our talents, our time, our money, our possessions, our hearts, our will are all His. He writes, everyone can know the power of the resurrected Christ. Through disappointments and trials, through all the circumstances of life, the resurrected Christ will go with you if you will put your trust in Him by faith. So many people are confused, lonely, discouraged. Give your life to Christ. Let Him transform your life so that you will have a glow on your face, a spring in your step, and a joy in your soul. Great words, aren't they? Romans 8:11 through 15 says, if the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, He who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through His Spirit who dwells in you. It goes on to say, so then, brothers, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. I might have told you the experience of some friends of mine who went to the Holy Land. They had a bus driver, a Jewish bus driver, who was driving around, and his son, his little son, was on the trip with him. And that word Abba literally means daddy. And that little Jewish boy was looking at his father and he was going, Abba, 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 Abba. And I said, boy, what a beautiful picture that is for us. That we can come to the Lord and cry, Abba, Abba. And He allows us to sit in His lap and love on us and comfort us and bring us through whatever it is we're facing. The promise of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, inspires one another. It empowers one another. The third observation is that the power of forgiveness supports one another. Jesus told the disciples, He said, if you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. If you don't forgive sins, what are you going to do with them? And then it goes on to say, but Thomas, sometimes called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. And the other disciples told Him, we saw the Master. But He said, unless I see the nail holes in His hands, put my finger in the nail holes and stick my hand in His side, I won't believe it. You know, the Bible doesn't talk a lot about Thomas, but I did some research and found out a little bit of the background of who Thomas was as a person. And I want to share that with you this morning. This apostle called Thomas, he had little education, but he possessed a keen reasoning mind and was the son of excellent parents who lived in Tiberias. Now, Thomas had the one truly analytical mind of the 12 apostles. He was the real scientist. of this apostolic group. And I found that the early home life of Thomas had been unfortunate. That although he had excellent parents, his parents were not altogether happy in their married life. And this was reflected in Thomas's adult experience. He grew up having a very disagreeable and quarrelsome disposition. Even his wife was glad to see him join the apostles. She was relieved by the thought that her pessimistic husband would be away from home most of the time. And Thomas also had a streak of suspicion. He was a skeptic, which made it very difficult to get along peaceably with him. Peter was very much upset by Thomas at first, complaining to his brother Andrew that Thomas was mean, ugly, and always suspicious. But the better his associates knew Thomas, the more they liked him. They found that he was superbly honest and unflinchingly loyal. He was perfectly sincere and unquestionably truthful. He hadn't learned that speak the truth in love thing yet. He was a natural born fault finder and had grown up to become a real pessimist in his personality. His analytical mind had become cursed with suspicion. And he was rapidly losing faith in his fellow men when he became associated with the 12 and thus came in contact with this noble character, Jesus. This association with the Master began at once to transform Thomas's whole disposition and to effect great changes in his mental reactions to his fellow men. Thomas's greatest strength was his superb analytical mind coupled with his unflinching courage. And when he had once and for all made up his mind, he was always on your side. His great weakness was this suspicious doubting, which he never fully overcame throughout his whole lifetime in the flesh. In the organization of the 12, Thomas was assigned to arrange and manage the itinerary for the apostles. And he was able he was the director of the work and the movements of the apostle corps. He was a good executive, an excellent businessman, but he was handicapped by his many moods. He was one man one day and another man the next. And so when we look at Thomas being in charge of the itinerary, it appears that Thomas was struggling again with this melancholy mood. Did he know what the itinerary was going to be? Yeah. He planned it. Yet he chose to not be present at that first meeting with Jesus. And when told that they had seen Jesus, he responded by saying, "Well, unless I see the nail holes, put my hand in his side, I don't believe it." Powerful picture of his personality, isn't it? Have you ever found yourself with Thomas's attitude? Yeah. Have you ever said, you know, unless it's really just proven to me, you know, I won't believe? And over 2,000 years later, the tag of being a doubting Thomas still remains attached to his name. Can you imagine something that you said or a choice that you made sticking to your name for that many years? Turbulent Teddy. Tumultuous Teddy. Whatever. You know, when I started reading this, I said how easy it would have been for Peter just to say, you know, look, I've had it with you. You know, I'm tired of this constant suspicion you have, your moodiness and all this attitude you always bring to the table. If you don't want to go with us, then you're out. As the Donald would say, you fire it. You're out. You're done. But that's not what the picture was. You see, in this moment, we see the power of forgiveness. Because Thomas was obviously renewed. Regardless of his attitude, he was restored to the fellowship of the apostles. They loved on him. They brought him back. They reminded him of the power of the resurrected Christ. And the next time they encounter Jesus, guess who's there? Thomas shows up. 8 days later, the Bible says, his disciples were again in the room. This time, Thomas was with them, and Jesus came through the locked doors, stood among them, and said, "Peace to you." Now, I want you to watch what happens next. Then Jesus speaks to the 12, and then he turns and focuses on Thomas. Thomas, come here. Take your finger. Examine my hands. Take your hand and stick it in my side. Don't be unbelieving. Believe. And then Thomas says, "My master, my God." You see, Jesus enjoyed Thomas very much. And he had many long personal talks with him. His presence among the apostles was a great comfort to all honest doubters and encouraged many troubled minds to come into the kingdom. Even if they could not wholly understand everything about the spiritual or the philosophical phases of the teachings of Jesus, Thomas, his presence, his membership, his being part of the 12 was a standing declaration that Jesus loved even honest doubters. That encourages me. Especially when I doubt. Especially when I fall short. When I fail. That there was one among the 12 who struggled with doubt, and yet Jesus met him where he is. He was. And Jesus said, "So you believe because you've seen with your own eyes. Even better blessings are in store for those who believe without seeing." So what does that mean for us? That even in those times of doubt, Jesus understands and he meets you where you are. And he will focus his attention on you and help you to believe in his way, his purpose for your life. As we learn to forgive others, as we learn to ask for forgiveness from those that we've hurt or harmed in some way, the power of forgiveness supports one another. And we truly become the body of Christ. The last observation is that the provision of God's word inspires us to believe. Jesus provided far more God-revealing signs than are written down in this book. But these, the ones that are there, these are written down so you will believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. And in the act of believing, have real life here on this earth and eternal life in the way that He, Jesus, personally revealed it through the Scriptures. The Bible tells us that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. That as we hear the Word of God, as we read the Word of God and study the Word of God, that our faith is increased, our maturity grows. Romans 10:17, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. What I've learned in 66 years, did I tell you that lately? What I've learned in 66 years is that there comes a time, maybe even a season in your life, where we struggle with our belief. Things happen. Losses occur. Tragedy strikes. Faith is weakened and obstacles arise. I don't know if you remember, there was a story in the book of Mark where Jesus confronted a father whose son was demon-possessed. And it's found in Mark chapter 9, verses 21 through 24. And Jesus is asking the father, he says, how, you know, the kid's over here flopping around, the demons got him and throwing him, all, tossing him all about. And he's going, how long has this been going on? And the father said, well, since he was a little boy. The spirit often throws him into the fire or into water, trying to kill him. And then the father says this to Jesus. He says, have mercy on us and help us if you can. And Jesus says, well, what do you mean if I can? Anything is possible if a person believes. That's what Jesus told him. And the father instantly cried out, I do believe, but help me overcome my unbelief. That's one of the most honest statements that you'll ever read in the Scripture. I believe. Help me with my unbelief. Philip Brooks writes, the Bible is like a telescope. If a man looks through his telescope, he sees worlds beyond. But if he just looks at his telescope, he does not see anything but the telescope. The Bible is a thing to be looked through, to see that which is beyond. But most people only look at it. They only look at the book laying there. Well, there it is, right there on my coffee table, right there on my nightstand. The Bible, B-I-B-L-E, right there. There it is. I'm going to get around to that thing one of these days. Yeah, there's a whole lot of words in that thing. There it is. And when we look at it that way, it becomes just a dead letter. It doesn't become the manual for life. It can't help you if it's not opened. But because of our relationship with Christ, John assures us in these scriptures that through the act of believing, that we can have real life on this earth and eternal life in the way that Christ himself revealed it. It's like I told you last week, we don't have to want, we don't have to wonder, we don't have to worry. Is this real? Is Christ really who he said he was? We have every bit of the proof we need in this manual. And if we read it and understand it and take it heart to heart by faith, as your faith is increased, the reality of who Jesus is becomes real. I tell you all the time, I'm not the role model. But thank God I know who he is. I don't live that perfect life. I struggle. I trip over my own feet. Rescue. They refused to testify against their captors. They raised money for their legal defense. And one of the female hostages later became engaged to one of her now jailed captors. And this psychological condition became known as the Stockholm Syndrome. And the Stockholm Syndrome comes into play when a captive cannot escape, is isolated and threatened with death, but is shown token acts of kindness by their captor. And so obviously this twisted state of the psyche got its name from the later studies of these events that transpired in Stockholm. But the same syndrome has since been seen in other situations in life. It's seen in battered wives, survivors of the Holocaust. There are not many of them left. And many situations like that. And this is what it basically boils down to. The victim feels helpless and has lost hope for relief from a situation, gropes and clings tenaciously to any little perceived goodness or benefit coming from the person or situation causing the problem, and eventually begins to sense a false love and a dedication to the very person or the circumstance that they've been imprisoned to. The same situation can happen to us spiritually. The enemy of your soul is a master of deception. And you got to remember what being deceived means. The definition of deception is something done to you without your knowledge. And the Bible calls Satan the father of lies. And just like these captors, we're deceived into believing in a false sense of security. And we have to be careful not to fall into that trap, that same type of trap. Because God's word helps us with that. We all struggle with our belief system at times. And the Bible is there to help us believe, to confirm what we believe and whom we have believed in, is what Paul says. What's next for us? Well, with the understanding that the presence of Jesus brings peace, the promise of the Spirit empowers, the power of forgiveness supports, and the provision of God's word inspires, we carry on the work that the Father, the Son, and now the Holy Spirit has called us and equipped us to do. 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says, "Therefore encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing." And not just for the one another's, but also for others. There are people still outside these walls who are desperately seeking, searching for the meaning of life. And it's up to us to share, to shine that light so that they and we continue to grow and become what I call fully devoted followers of Christ. FDFX. Fully devoted followers of Christ. The same word that Jesus gave to the disciples is the same word that he gives to us. Just as the Father sent me, I send you. Peace be to you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the power of your word. We thank you, Lord, that in the presence of the Lord there is peace. That the promise of your Holy Spirit indwelling us empowers us to do things that seem like an impossibility. We thank you for the power of forgiveness. And we thank you for the provision of your word that continues to guide us and lead us and direct us when we will spend time in it. I pray today, Father, that you will encourage us to keep on connecting with people, letting them see Jesus in us. And yes, we'll use words when we have to. But let them see Jesus in us first, Lord. Use this ministry to do impossible things. We give you the glory for it, God. Because in every way possible, Lord, we try to stay out of your way. We try to give you a place and a presence here to do whatever it is you want in the lives of the people who come. Bless them, O Lord. Peace be to them. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Thank you guys for coming. God bless you.